on a true story. All right. This song is called Alice's Restaurant. It's about Alice and the restaurant. But Alice's Restaurant was never the name of the restaurant. It's just the name of the song. That's why the song is still called Alice's Restaurant. You can get anything you want at Alice's Restaurant. You can get anything you want at Alice's Restaurant. Walk right in, it's around the back, just a half a mile from the railroad track. You can get anything you want at Alice's Restaurant. And it all started 51 years ago. 51 Thanksgivings ago. 51 years ago on Thanksgiving, when a friend and I went up to visit Alice at the restaurant, but Alice doesn't live in the restaurant. She lives in the church nearby the restaurant in the bell tower with her husband Ray and Pasha the dog. And living in the bell tower like that, they got a lot of room downstairs where the pews used to be in. Having all that room, seeing as how they took out all the pews, they decided they didn't have to take out their garbage for a long time. Got up there, found all the garbage. Then we decided it'd be a friendly gesture for us to take the garbage down to the town dump. So we took the half a ton of garbage, put it in the back of a red VW microbus with shovels and rakes and implements of destruction, headed on towards the town dump. When we got there, there was a big sign and a chain across the road saying, closed on Thanksgiving. We had never heard of a dump closed on Thanksgiving before. So with tears in our eyes, we drove off into the sunset, looking for another place to put the garbage. We couldn't find one. Till we came to a side road, and off the side of the side road was another 15-foot cliff, and at the bottom of the cliff was another pile of garbage. So we decided that one big pile is better than two little piles, and rather than bring that one up, we decided to throw ours down. That's what we did. Drove back to the church, had a Thanksgiving dinner that couldn't be beat, went to sleep and didn't get up until the next morning when we got a phone call from Officer Obie. Said, kid, we found your name on an envelope at the bottom of a half a ton of garbage. So I don't know if you had any information about it. I said, yes, sir, Officer Obie, I cannot tell a lie. I put that envelope under that garbage. After speaking to Obie for about 45 minutes on the telephone, we finally arrived at the truth of the matter. He said we had to go down and pick up the garbage, and also had to go down and talk to him at the police officer station. So we got back in the red VW microbus with the shovels and rakes and implements of destruction and headed on towards the police officer station. Now, friends, there was only one or two things that Obie could have done to us at the police station. And the first thing was he could have given us a medal for being so brave and honest on the telephone, which wasn't very likely, and we didn't expect it. The other thing was he could have bawled us out and told us never to be seen driving garbage around the vicinity again, which was what we expected. But when we got to the police officer station, there was a third possibility we hadn't even counted upon, and we was both immediately arrested, handcuffed. And I said, Obie, I can't pick up the garbage with these handcuffs on. He said, shut up, kid. Get in the back of the patrol car. And that's what we did. We sat in the back of the patrol car and drove to the, quote, scene of the crime, unquote. Now, I want to tell you about this town called Stockbridge, Massachusetts, where this is happening here. They got three stop signs, two police officers, and one police car. And when we got to the scene of the crime, there was five police officers and three police cars, being the biggest crime of the last 50 years, and everybody wanted to be in the newspaper story about it. And they was using up all kinds of cop equipment they had hanging around the police officer station. They took plaster, tire, track prints, footprints, dog smelling prints. They took 27 8x10 colored glossy pictures with circles and arrows and a paragraph on the back of each one explaining what each one was to be used as evidence against them. Took pictures of the approach, getaway, northwest corner, southwest corner, and that's not to mention the aerial photography. After the ordeal, we went back to the jail. Obi said he was going to put us in the cell. I said, kid, I'm going to put you in the cell. I want your wallet and your belt. I said, Obi, I can understand you want my wallet, so I don't have any money to spend in the jail, but what do you want my belt for? He said, kid, we don't want any hangings. I said, Obi, you think I'm going to hang myself for littering? Obi said he was making sure, friends Obi was, because he took out the toilet seat so I wouldn't hit myself over the head and drown. Then he took out the toilet paper so I wouldn't bend the bars and roll the toilet paper out the window, slide down the roll, and have an escape. Obi was making sure. It was about 4 or 5 hours later when Alice, remember Alice, this song's about Alice. Alice came by with a few nasty words to Obi on the side, bailed us out of jail. We went back to the church, had another Thanksgiving dinner that couldn't be beat, and didn't get up until the next morning when we all had to go to court. We walked in, we sat down. Obi walked in with a 27 8x10 colored glossy pictures with the circles and arrows and a paragraph on the back, and he sat down. Man came in, said, all right. We all stood up. Obi stood up with the 27 8x10 colored glossy pictures with the circles and arrows. The judge walked in, sat down. He had a seeing eye dog, and he sat down. We sat down. Obi looked at the seeing eye dog. Then at the 27 8x10 colored glossy pictures with the circles and arrows, and looked at the seeing eye dog. Then at the 27 8x10 colored glossy pictures with the circles and arrows, and he began to cry. Because Obi came to the realization there was another typical case of American blind injustice, and there was nothing he could do about it. And the judge wasn't going to look at the 27 8x10 colored glossy pictures with the circles and arrows. It didn't matter anyway. And we were fined $50 and had to go pick up the garbage in the snow. That's not what I came to tell you about, though. I came to talk about the draft. Those of you who weren't there or don't remember, when you was 18 and you was a guy, you got a letter from the Selective Services Registry, and you had to select the service that suited you best. And if you selected none of the above, well, they'd help you. They would select a service for you. And they had all these buildings all across the country you had to pay a visit to, like the one in New York City. It was on Whitehall Street. You'd walk in, you'd get injected, inspected, infected, detected, neglected, and selected. I went down to get my physical examination there one day. Got good and drunk the night before, so I looked and felt my best when I went in that morning. Because I wanted to feel like the all-American kid from New York City. Man, I wanted to be the all-American kid from New York City. I walked in, I sat down, I was hung down, rung down, hung up with all kinds of mean, nasty, ugly things. Handed me some papers, said, kid, see the psychiatrist, room 604. I walked up there, I said, shrink, I wanna kill. I want to see blood and gore and guts and veins in my teeth. Eat dead, burnt bodies. I mean kill. 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 And I started jumping up and down, yelling, kill, kill, kill. And he was jumping up and down with me. We was both jumping up and down, yelling, kill, kill, kill. That's when the sergeant came in, pinned the medal on me, sent me down the hallway and said, you're our boy. Didn't feel too good about it. Proceeded on down the hall, going through more injections, inspections, infections, detections, deflections, all kinds of stuff they was doing to me at the room there. And I was there for 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours. Man, I was there for a long time, going through all kinds of mean, nasty, ugly things, and just having a tough time. And they was injecting, inspecting every single part of me, and they was leaving no part untouched. Finally came down to the very last man. I walked in, I sat down after going through a whole big thing there. I walked in, I sat down, I said, hey, what you want? He said, kid, we only have one question. Have you ever been arrested? I proceeded to telling the story of the Alice's Restaurant Massacre, the four-part harmony and folk orchestration, another phenomena. He stopped me right there and he said, kid, did you ever go to court? I proceeded to tell the story of the 27 8x10 colored glossy pictures with the circles and arrows and a paragraph on the back of each one. He stopped me right there and he said, kid, I want you to go and sit down on that bench that says Group W. Now, kid. Well, I walked over to the bench there. Now, Group W is where they put you. If you may not be moral enough to join the army after committing your special crime, there's all kinds of mean, nasty, ugly looking people on the bench there. Mother rapers, father stabbers, father rapers sitting on the bench right next to me. One mean, nasty, ugly, horrible crime fighting guys are sitting on the bench. And the meanest, nastiest, ugliest one, the meanest father raper of them all, he was sitting right next to me. He was mean and nasty and horrible, all kinds of things. He looked at me and he said, kid, what'd you get? I said, I didn't get nothing. I had to pay $50 and pick up the garbage. He said, what were you arrested for, kid? I said, littering. And they all moved away from me on the bench there, the hairy eyeball and all kinds of mean, nasty things. So I said, and creating a nuisance. Then they all came back, shook my hand. We had a fun time, talked about crime, mother raping, father stabbing, all kinds of groovy things. We were smoking cigarettes and everything was fine. So the sergeant came over, had some paper in his hand, held it up, and he said, kids, this piece of paper's got 47 words, 57 sentences, says, we don't know the detail, the crime, the time, the crime, the other, 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 the I filled out the massacre with the full part harmony and folk orchestration and put down the pencil and I turned over the paper. And there on the other side, away from everything else on the other side, in parentheses, capital letters, quotated, read the following words. Kid, have you rehabilitated yourself? I looked at the sergeant. I said, son, you got a lot of damn gall to ask me if I have rehabilitated myself. I'm sitting here on this bench. I'm sitting here on Group W bench. Because you want to know if I'm moral enough to join the army, kill innocent women, burn houses and villages after being a litter bug. He said, kid, we don't like your kind. We're sending your fingerprints off to Washington. And friends, somewhere in Washington, enshrined in some folder as a study in black and white, are those fingerprints. They're still there. It's been 51 freaking years. It's because recently they've been taking a collection. And the only reason why I'm singing this song tonight and still singing this song is you might know somebody in a collection like that. Or you might be in a collection like that. And if you ever think you're in a collection, there's only one thing you can do. Well, there may not be much you can do. There's something you can try. Is wherever you're at, right now, get on your Facebooks right now. Check yourself in to Boston's on the Beat. Tag all of your friends, everybody you know. And in that little spot where it says, what's on your mind? Type this in or take a selfie of yourself. And maybe take a video of yourself and go like this. Ready? Real quick. You can get anything you want at Alice's Restaurant. And that's it. That's all you got. Hit post. Just one person. That's all it takes. Maybe just one person starts something. Maybe two people singing, holding hands. Maybe they're just trying to get married in Kentucky or Ohio or someplace like that. Maybe they're just trying to use the bathroom in North Carolina. Could be anyone. Could be 50 people singing Alice's Restaurant. 10,000 people, 50,000. Can you imagine 50,000 people singing Alice's Restaurant? Now that's what you call a movement. There might be some people who might think they don't know what a movement is. But that's what it was, and that's what it will always be. It's the Alice's Restaurant Anti-Massacre Movement. And the best way to join this movement is to sing it the next time it comes on the guitar. Or unless somebody comes along and writes another song. That hasn't happened yet. So here it comes. You can't get anything you want at Alice's Restaurant. You can't get anything you want at Alice's Restaurant. Walk right in, it's around the back, just to have a mile from the railroad track. Well, that was okay. That was okay. I hear mostly people singing down front. I don't know if people are singing way in the back. Are you singing way in the back there? That's what we used to call the cheap seats. So what we're going to do, we're going to do it nice and loud one more time. So everybody driving down A1A tonight and figure out what's going on in there. Or they can say, hey, I know that song. So we're singing nice and loud. We've got a long night of music ahead of us. So we're going to make sure you guys are ready. So here it comes. Nice and loud.
You can get anything you want at Alice's Restaurant.
Except in Alice's.
You can get anything you want at Alice's Restaurant.
Harmony.
Walk right in.
That's Jason Colanino. He's going to be returning as Neil Young. You better be ready for that. Good evening.
When I get off of this mountain, you know where I wanna go. Straight down the Mississippi River to the Gulf. So I took her on my wedding
You have no idea the shape that we're in tonight.
I'm scream. You shouldn't have heard just what I said. Singing, who do you love? So we're going to keep the legs like right about here. This was Big Medicine. We want to introduce to the stage now. Yeah, go ahead. Give it up for Big Medicine one more time. We're going to hold on to Brother Time, I think, on this one. And Diamond Joe George on the keyboards. But we're going to bring up Richie Schmidt, Tess Schmidt, and Jim Jones. So give us a minute. We'll get that organized. Then Billy will hit the... And we'll lower the, and we'll do the, and we'll get going. How's that sound? All right!
Oh,
ladies and gentlemen, Michael McClure. You all know the doctor? Dr. John? Pat Gravenak? Mel Saba? To the band and all the fellas. Such a night. Yeah. Hotel Mel as Mac Remenack, Dr. John. Now, you remember the cat that started this whole thing out, right, Jason? Well, give him a bigger round of applause.
Change your logic, tied it across my door.
That was Jason and Kim Colonito. And these two beautiful souls reestablish my faith in humanity. Every time I see them, give them another big, warm, loving. Thank you so much, you guys.
Yeah. Thank you.
You don't have a volume. So we're going to work on the acoustic guitar on our side. That's a lot. We'll trim it back a little.
Yeah.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, Kristen Capiello as Joni Mitchell.
Yeah.
another song that is just too good. House Lights! Everything gonna be all right now. Yeah!
Jerry Lehman, the leader of the band. A singing natural born man.
Thank you. G-spot on the bass guitar.
Forever, I know. Thank you. Austin's on the beach.
Treat your love for money. Maybe you're a woman.
Hey, thank you guys so very, very much for being here. Give it up one more time for Boston for having us. Good night, everybody. Thank you.